Because he died. And as Catholics in today's world, we are challenged to actually make God number one in our lives. To put our neighbors, sex, and ourselves as number three. In the gospel reading today, a scholar of the law, a lawyer, is trying to test Jesus by publicly prosecuting him with questions like, "Teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus answers the question with a question. What does the law say? And probably every Jewish person there says, "Ooh, I know, I know." Because they didn't have to be scholars of the law, they didn't have to be lawyers to know their basic Jewish prayers by heart. "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your being, with all your strength, with all your mind, and your neighbors as yourself." They would have been taught these words, these statutes, from the time they were very small children. Much like many of us frail Catholics might have learned the sign of the cross of our Father and the Hail Mary before we could even talk. Just the same, Jesus affirms the scholar's obvious answer and says, "Do this, you will live." Which is another way of saying, if you don't do that, Mr. Scholar of the Law, you won't inherit eternal life. The lawyer must have started squirming a bit because although he could quote the law, he knew in his heart that he wasn't living up to it completely. As a matter of fact, if any of us could completely love God with all our hearts, our being, strength, mind, and our neighbors as ourselves, His grace, then we wouldn't be sinless, and Christ would have died for no reason. But of course, we are sinners. We can't save ourselves, so Jesus has done it for us. The Lord tries another line of questioning by asking Jesus, "And so, who is my neighbor?" Now, the Jewish people that day, the Samaritans, were despised because they intermarried with pagans. Foreigners who were entitled. Hatred between the Samaritans and the Jewish people had lasted hundreds of years, so the thought of them being neighbors wasn't going over so good. But Jesus tells them a story about a Samaritan who rescues and cares for the victims of the robbers after the Jewish priest and the Levite do nothing to help. Jesus uses this parable to show us, them, and everyone who our neighbors are and how we are to love and care for them. St. Paul, our second reading, tells us that Jesus Christ is the image of the invisible God, and he is. But not only for those people 2,000 years ago who saw him, but also for us today, although he may not look the way we expect him. Many wouldn't believe or think that Jesus could be visible in the appearance of bread and wine in the Eucharist, but he is. And when he receives the Holy Communion, Jesus joins his heart, his being, his strength, and his mind to ours. So that we can completely love God and our neighbor and ourselves. Because we're no longer just us. We're Christ who lives within us. He saves us for eternal life. Before Jesus ascended into heaven, he gave us a new commandment to love one another as he has loved us. And how does Jesus love us? He gives his life away for us. Even though he's Almighty God, even though in the order of all things, visible and invisible, he is number one, he chooses to make himself number three. And asks us to go and do likewise. Because whatever we do to the least of our brothers and sisters, our neighbors, we do or don't do to Jesus himself. That means that loving God and our neighbor go hand in hand because Christ is present and visible when we see our neighbor's need. Even when that neighbor doesn't look much like we think. where hundreds of displaced, hungry, and homeless people stood in line for hours in order to get food from the back of a large supply truck. He was snapping pictures and noticed a young girl around 10 or 11 years old in line by herself with no adult. She seemed to be preoccupied with looking at something off in the distance as she moved through the line, and as the afternoon rolled on, the food began to run low. So by the time the little girl reached the supply truck, all she was able to get after being in line for hours was a single banana. But she smiled and said thank you. Then she skipped off toward the area that she had been so interested in all afternoon. The photojournalist kept an eye on her through his telephoto lens as she reached a small grove of bushes. And to his surprise, he saw three smaller children run out to meet her. And they all sat down together. The young girl paused, made the sign of the cross, and they all bowed their heads to pray. Then she peeled the banana and broke it into three equal parts and gave one to each.